This is George Lewis.
And this is Marcus Brigstock.
And this
is YSTV.
You're now joining us inside. We're in the exclusive YSTV dressing room, where just in a minute we'll be joined by tonight's acts for an exclusive interview.
Hello, I'm George Lewis. I'm one of the comedians I've just performed, actually, to the Freshers Week crowd. And it was brilliant.
I'm Marcus Brigstock. I'm the other comedian. I've not been on yet, so we can't say with any confidence how it will go.
It will be good. It will be good.
No, like, just if you want to do it, do it, and gig as the only way you can get good is gig loads.
Yeah, I agree. That's the advice that I never wanted to hear when I started out. I wanted the advice to be, well, as long as you craft your material and you go out, that's all you really need to do. Because to me, the thought of gigging all the time was awful. But actually, that is how you get good. And for me as well, it was the more I gigged, the more I enjoyed it. And now, it's the best job in the world. But definitely starting off is the hardest thing. I found that the hardest thing, because that's when you're at your worst as well. Mm. But what's great about the job is it just gets more and more fun as you carry on.
That's absolutely true. I mean, the other thing, as a sort of principle of performance that I believe in, is that the only pleasurable thing to watch is pleasure. Right? It comes, I think, from Goliath, who runs Le Coq in Paris. And I do think that that's true. And I think that you can see people across all areas of performance, if they're not having a good time, it's impossible to really enjoy what they're doing. And there are comics whose work I like who are a bit over it.
Yeah.
And it's not fun to watch them, you know? Whereas there are people whose material might not be dynamite, but if they're having fun on stage, they are a joy to watch. And I always say, like, if you think about your pissed uncle at a wedding dancing.
Yeah.
If he's truly abandoned in his dancing, no matter how awful that dancing is, there is something joyful about it that you will watch. And it's kind of that. So my hope tonight is that I'll be a pissed uncle.
For me, it was, I just wanted to be a writer. That's what I wanted to be. I wanted to, I'd watch The Office, and I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to write and be in a very successful sitcom. And then I'd read, I think Stephen Merchant had said, the way in is you do stand-up and you get to know people, and that's how you. So I thought, it's worth giving it a go. So I just booked in one gig when I was living in London. I didn't tell my girlfriend or anything. I just booked a gig, 5 minutes, about a month ahead, and I thought, I'll just write 5 minutes of material. If it's awful, I'll never mention it to anyone. and I just went, and it was, looking back, I think it was awful, but at the time, it was good enough for me to think, I'll try that again. And then you do 5 gigs, you do 10 gigs, and then suddenly, it becomes your job, because it just gets more and more fun.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of, it sounds like a cliche, but I genuinely knew at my first gig, which mostly did not go very well, the last couple of minutes did, but most of the rest of it didn't really, but I knew as I walked off stage, like, this is it, this is the thing I want to do more than anything else, and I didn't really know that beforehand. It was terrifying and all of that. But just on, because you mentioned The Office and Stephen Merchant, I made a sitcom years ago for BBC One. Big prime time, written by the biggest writer at that time. The BBC were coming, they were taking us out for fancy dinners and all that. I was being introduced to all the people. And some people I knew, some were friends, people I knew vaguely, were also shooting in the same studio. And there was no one looking after them, and it looked like they didn't know what they were up to and stuff. And I sat with a mate of mine, and I says, "What are you making?" And he said, "Oh, it's sitcom, non-audience, single camera." I went, "Okay, and where's it set?" "In an office." "Okay, and what's it called?" "The Office." And I genuinely felt bad for them. I was like, "Oh shit!" Yeah. Like, I hope, you're all good guys too. I hope this is all right.
Yeah.
And then The Office came out, and my sitcom tanked so deep, like it sunk without trace. And I watched The Office, and I literally was like that. Oh God! Oh, it's right next to. And I had a column in The Guardian at the time, and I wrote a piece about how brilliant The Office was, and it really was. It was a game changer. And Stephen Merchant phoned me up, and he went, "Oh, mate, I've just seen what you wrote about The Office, and I just was ringing to say a couple of things. Firstly, thank you so much. And secondly, we're shooting the second season any minute, and I hope you enjoy that too. Cheers.
Now. It's York Uni. York Uni in September 22. It's that's when it all changed for me, really. That one was really nice. I mean, that type of gig is exactly the type of gig which is nice, because you just go out there and you just feel like it's an audience full of people who want to laugh. But probably my favourite one was the first time I ever did a really big room, and it's when our agents do a showcase up in Edinburgh, and it's at the Playhouse there, which is like, I don't know, it's a few thousand people. And the first time that I did that during a festival, because before then it had only ever been a few hundred people at the most, and when you have thousands of people laughing at you, it's just completely different. And it's never felt that good again, actually, I don't think, because it was so different to hear that amount of laughter coming back at you. I just felt amazing. And it's never been as good.
I got asked to go on the Pyramid stage at Glastonbury to talk about CND. It was just before Barack Obama became president, and he was talking about reducing the nuclear stockpile. Yeah. And I felt it was a good time. I've been a member of CND all my life, and I felt it was a good time to engage with it. And they asked me to go on, so I said, "Yeah, but let's try and put me on like next to a band that will likely draw a sort of sympathetic audience."
Yeah.
And I was on just before the Fleet Foxes, but just after. NERD, Nerd, and a crowd of 60,000 people were still chanting, angrily chanting, NERD, and like this. and the bloke went, "There you go, your mic's live." And I walked forward and went, "Hello, I'm on Radio 4, and I want to talk to you about nuclear proliferation and CND." And literally 60,000 people in one voice went, it was probably that. It was probably the greatest moment, because all heckles that have come since then have just been like, I've just been like, yeah. I mean, I got booed by 60,000 people at once.
Yeah.
So, but no, the best. The tour I did a couple of years ago, just before the pandemic, I wrote a tour show as Lucifer. And painted myself red with horns and did the whole thing and embodied a different character for an entire tour. And I've never, you know, I've been a stand-up for 25 years, and it was really exciting just to do something from a completely different point of view. And even though, like, getting painted and depainted after every gig was like, oh, God, that was really thrilling to do as a show, because it was just a completely different tack, you know. So
I remember, so one show that is a lot of people do as a rite of passage when they start is you do the gong shows at the Comedy Store. So that's basically you go on and you last as long as you can, and people in the audience have got a card to hold up, three cards, they gong you off, and I remember arriving at that, not wanting to do it too early, thinking I need to be bulletproof before I go and do this, and I remember getting to the point where I was going, I was really nervous, but in my head I was thinking, I think I'm going to do quite well here, because I thought I had like a good 5 minutes. And I went out, and before I'd even told my first joke, I think I think I might have gone, "Hiya," or I'd gone, "Hi, I'm George," and someone went, "You cunt." And then someone else burst out laughing. Then someone else put the card up. And then two other people put the card up. And then I got gonged off. And I'd not even said anything. And I thought, oh, fuck. And then I thought, is that what you've got to go through to do it? And after that, I thought, well, you know.
That's so brutal, man.
Yeah.
I once had a leg thrown at me. A leg? Yeah. So I was doing a gig and a guy took his leg off. A prosthetic leg, and threw it at me, and it was so, like, it really threw me, you know. I wasn't like, if it happened now I'd find it very funny and I'd play with the leg and everything, but I didn't. I was like, oh no, I got kicked from over 10 feet away, you know. And anyway, it was John Bishop was the compere, And John made that story part of his tour show, which I didn't know. He went on to be much more famous. And he'd tell this story about this posh London comedian and a leg thrown at him. And I was on in, I think it was like Gloucestershire, somewhere like that. And I came on stage before I'd even started. John Bishop had been on the week before. And someone said, is it true you once had a leg thrown at you? And I was like, it was the first thing. And I went, well, yeah, actually, as it happens, did. And it happened again. And they'd set it up. There was a guy with a prosthetic leg. So I've literally had half a man thrown at me on stage. Both of those were quite awkward, I'd say. But you're not, I mean, I don't really believe in the, like, until you've had a really miserable death, you're not a great comic. But until you've recovered from not doing your job very well and worked out the ways, you know, that's, it is kind of how you get better at it, you know. And there were some brutal gigs. Up the Creek on a Sunday night was in London, was a, that was brutal. But I never did the Frog and Bucket. Never done it. Have you done
really?
It?
Really? Yeah.
That's infamous. The Frog and Bucket's infamous for destroying comedians.
Yeah.
But it's also a great club, you know what I mean? Like, it's it's legit. I think I've got to go to work.
I think that's us.
Wise question, what's your favourite biscuit?
Bourbon for me.
Bourbon?
Oh, goodness. One with a lot of cheese sitting on top of it. Any biscuit with a load of cheese on it.